Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Jack Knott, and I'm the Dean of the Saul Price School of Public Policy here at USC. And on behalf of the school, it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the campus. I realize that this is the evening of the USC-UCLA basketball game, so you are particularly dedicated to this event tonight, and we're so thankful to see you here at the George Washington Leadership Lecture. I thought it would be fitting to start with a little bit of trivia about presidents, something you may not know, that USC has actually hosted 10 US presidents: Taft, FDR, Kennedy, Nixon, Ford, Reagan, both Bushes, Clinton, and President Obama. And we'll see whether we have the next president continue that tradition. The George Washington Leadership Lecture Series was launched in 2013 as a partnership between the Saul Price School and the Fred W. Smith National Library. Together, our goal is to explore President Washington's lifelong accomplishments, providing a better understanding of him as a person, as well as his remarkable leadership, his professional achievements, and his amazing lasting legacy as the founding father of our country. We've designed the series to be bi-coastal. We typically host a fall lecture at Mount Vernon, and then each January, we bring the conversation to Southern California. Now, this collaboration was made possible by two very special people, Mary Beth and Hal Borthwick. They are here tonight. Would they please rise, and may we recognize their contribution. Mary Beth she serves as the Vice Regent for California of the Mount Vernon Ladies Association. And for those of you who don't know, it's the Ladies Association that run and own Mount Vernon. And it has done so since 1860. So it's a long-standing, amazing organization. We're also pleased to host our partners from the Fred W. Smith National Library, including the founding director, Doug Bradburn. So let's give Doug and the members from the library a round of applause as well. We'd also like to acknowledge a few special guests who have joined us here tonight. There are two members of our Board of Counselors. First, and let me mention both of them, and then we'll recognize them as a group. One is Kim Belche, and the other is Deborah Castro and her husband, Larry. Would you please stand and be acknowledged? Thank you. And, you know, what makes our school great is clearly the students, but especially the faculty. We have a really remarkable faculty, so I want to acknowledge all the Price faculty that are here tonight. So if you're a faculty member at the Price School, would you please stand up and be acknowledged? Thank you very much. So the Price School was established more than 85 years ago. It's one of the oldest and highest ranked public affairs schools in the country. In his inaugural address, nearly 230 years ago, President Washington referenced such ideals as the pursuit of the public good, a regard for the public harmony, and the preservation of the sacred fire of liberty. And the Price School really draws inspiration from these words and embraces the values they represent. Underscoring all of the work that we do is a commitment to public service and to really shaping the world for the better. We prepare our students to be the next generation of leaders in the public, private, nonprofit sectors, and they're committed to serving the greater good and are passionate about making a difference in their communities. In partnership with the Fred W. Smith National Library, we look forward to advancing the study of George Washington and convening events like this one that help everyone understand our ever-changing times. Our discussion this evening takes place, as you know, just 5 days into the new presidency of President Trump. With such a recent transfer of power, there are many policy questions that are still yet to be answered. But we recognize the profound effect that the expected policy changes and the decisions will have, as well as their implications, both locally and globally. This evening, we have the opportunity to examine the new president and his administration through an analytical lens. As we delve into important policy issues, perhaps including healthcare, economic development and trade, immigration, the environment, and national security. But while we disagree or agree on these and other policies, and I emphasize that the Price School is nonpartisan, this is election, even as we were discussing just before we came out, is unlike any in recent memory. It has exposed deep divisions between cities and rural areas in the country, between those with a college degree and those without a degree, and between the coastal areas and the rest of the country. For many people, it also has raised the specter of xenophobia, nationalism, racism, and women's rights. And the weekend's women's protest marches around the world are really unprecedented as a protest a day after an American election. In addition, the post-truth, alternative facts, and false news phenomenon is disturbing and challenging to the basic idea of democracy, whether one is a Republican or a Democrat, not to mention the evidence-based policy analysis that we attempt to do as a public policy school. We also live in a time of profound distrust of the political establishment, the news media, experts of all kinds, and even the democratic system itself. But I think that we all agree that at some level, there is some level of trust that is required, that is a prerequisite for a peaceful functioning and an open and free society. Fortunately, we have with us tonight a renowned journalist and political correspondent, Mara Liasson, to guide us and to embark on a timely discussion on navigating politics and policy in this new political era. But before we introduce Mara Liasson, at this time I do want to introduce our co-sponsor of this event, Dr. Doug Bradburn. Dr. Bradburn is the founding director of the Fred W. Smith National Library for the Study of George Washington at Mount Vernon, and he's a well-known scholar of early American history, and I've heard him speak several times, and I've learned more about George Washington and early American history than I ever imagined possible, and it's fascinating. And he has authored books and numerous articles and book chapters on the history of the nation's founding and the early history of the Chesapeake. He is also co-founder of the book series Early American Histories at the University of Virginia Press. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Doug Bradburn.
Thank you so much, Jack, for that introduction, and I'm delighted to be here again at this special evening and this great relationship with the Saul Price School. I'm going to talk a little bit about Mount Vernon, just to orient you Californians to what that is, and I'm going to get my pound of flesh. I was a former professor, and so I miss the opportunity to lecture at you guys before you get the real program. The Mount Vernon Ladies Association is an extraordinary organization, which Jack mentioned. It's an all-women-run, nonprofit educational institution that's been in existence really since 1852, at a time when the country was going through some pretty troubling momentum that ultimately led to a civil war. This group of women, at a time when most women weren't even allowed to own property or in their own right, came together and raised the money to buy George Washington's home and estate that was falling into disrepair. The state of Virginia didn't want it, the U.S. Congress didn't want it, and so this group of women said, well, if the men of America won't save the father of the country's home, then the women shall, and they did, and they have, and they've run it since 1860. Over 85 million people have visited the estate, and they, in addition to inventing historic preservation in the United States, they now also have an educational mission, and so they have a great museum and education center there, and opened in 2013 a presidential library for George Washington, figuring all these other dopes get a presidential library, so why can't George Washington have one as well? And I'm honored to be the first director of that institution. Now, since you couldn't be at the library today, I decided to bring a piece of the library to you today, and it's a very important book which speaks to the themes of the evening that we're going to talk about, the presidency, which is, of course, an office that George Washington invented. He was the first president. And this is a book that was purchased in 2012 as the Ladies Association was building the library. They purchased it at auction at Christie's for $9.8 million. Now, that's a pretty expensive book. It was the most expensive American book bought at auction at the time. And the reason it's so important, I think, will come across as we talk this evening about the presidency and the legacy of Washington in that regard. Why is it so significant? Well, George Washington was inaugurated in April of 1789, and the first session of the first Congress that met under the Constitution met between March and September of that year. They created the executive branch, they created the judiciary, they passed the first tax laws in America, and they passed the resolutions that ultimately became known as the Bill of Rights, something we all care deeply about. And then they gave, you know, they printed out what they did in that session, their annals from that session, and they gave it to George Washington, and he went and had it bound. So he put this beautiful binding on it. It says the President of the United States. It's got beautiful marbling. It's got his book plate in it. It's got his signature on the title page, his beautiful George Washington signature. And all those things would make it a significant historical artifact of this first president from this first session of Congress. But it also has a copy of the Constitution in the front of it. And sometime between receiving this book in the fall of 1789 and giving the first State of the Union address in January of 1790, George Washington sat down and reread his Constitution, and he marked it up in the margins. And so Article 1, as you all know, is all about the legislative branch and limits and enumerates the powers of Congress. In those areas where the powers are mixed and mingled with the presidency, he put his beautiful little surveyor's brackets around it, and he wrote, President. Okay, so this is his job. Right, so the veto power, the power of the Senate to ratify treaties with the presidency. Article 2, as you know, is all about the presidency. It says the executive power shall be vested in a president of the United States. So right at the top, he writes, President. Okay, so this is all his job description, you know, and he's getting down in it here. And when it says he shall have power, he writes, President powers. And then when it says, he shall take care the laws be faithfully executed, he writes, required. Now, this is an extraordinary document because this is the first president, he'd already been president for 9 months, looking again at the fundamental law that frames this country's government and making sure that he was doing what he was expected to do. It speaks a lot to a man who really was a great leader at the height of his powers at this moment. And in fact, at the moment he's doing this, he writes a letter to a woman named Catherine Macaulay Graham, who's an English historian. And when she talks about how difficult it'd been in his position, he writes, I walk on untrodden ground. Everything I do is subject to a dual interpretation. Everything I do is making a precedent. I mean, he's very aware of what he's doing in that moment. He calls America the last great experiment in human happiness under civil society. You know, and I think that we need to recognize that how present Washington's legacy has been since the election. There's been a lot of controversy, a president that didn't win the popular vote with arguments about foreign interference. But of course, we didn't have a military coup. And one of the reasons we didn't is we don't have a tradition of that in our republic, although many others do. George Washington refused to use the army to press Congress to pass laws at the Newburgh Conspiracy in 1783 at the end of the war, then resigned his commission and gave up power. George Washington resigned after 2 terms in office, unanimously elected in the Electoral College, and went back to a civilian life and allowed, not only because he wanted to, but also because he believed that American democracy was more than one person in charge. And that transition, that peaceful transition of power, which we did have again this year, is a direct legacy of Washington's moment and his understanding his moment. As he wrote about his presidency, he said, some things had to be done with prudence, some with conciliation, and some with firmness. And I think that, you know, that's the standard of judgment that he brought to bear. And when you think about, you know, how we understand the presidency, think about Washington reading Article 2. Because, you know, our Article 1, which frames the legislative branch, it limits the powers of the legislature. And the Congress, of course, isn't in session all the time. The judiciary in Article 3 is limited on what kind of cases that they can adjudicate. But the executive power invested in the president is open. And Washington was the person who defined and restrained that power in that initial role in it. Pierce Butler, who was one of the framers of the Constitutional Convention, when asked, why did you make the presidency so open-ended in terms of its possible power? And he wrote, the powers vested in the president might not have been so great had not the members cast their eyes towards George Washington as president. So that legacy is, the office, it comes directly from how he framed it out. You know, he made it the people's office, he established the cabinet, he established the foreign policy as the precedent of the president and under the control of the executive branch. His administration had the first separation of powers incident, and of course he established the precedent of two terms in office. But beyond that, he gave life and restraint and meaning to this office that is so important to the meaning of American democracy, which I hope we hear a lot about today. So of course, Washington established the presidency, but each president makes it their own. George Washington didn't tweet, if anybody was wondering, right? So I think we'll have a great program trying to understand how this presidency is evolving today in really unprecedented circumstances. So let's get to the main event. And it's my great honor to introduce David Sloan, who's going to lead you through this conversation. He's one of the great professors here at the Saul Price School, and I've known him now for a few years. And I'm just always impressed with the humanity that he brings to the discipline of history. You know, a lot of historians, like me, were really egomaniacs, and we want to make everything about ourselves. See that? I did that on purpose, right? But David, I mean, he's an historian who actually is interested in affecting public policy. He's engaged in trying to make the world a better place, which the mission of the Saul Price School, which I always say is, what a great mission. I mean, that's the mission to have, to try to make the world better than you inherited it. So David's an important part of making that happen. He's a specialist in urban planning, policy, and history, and many other things. He's written numerous books and award-winning articles. And please, everybody give a big round of applause to David Sloan. Oh, one more thing, David. This is not the actual book that was... This is a facsimile.
I was going to tell you that. I think the librarian at his library would have gone, where are
That's
the
right.
gloves?
That's right.
Thank you, Doug. George Washington was a unique historical figure. The first president, as Doug has gone through so beautifully, is a reluctant political figure, happy to stay at home, but compelled to serve his country. During his presidency, as Doug has suggested, he faced not just a series of decisions, but a series of challenge. He had to think about foreign and domestic issues. He had to establish tariffs, create a foreign policy, create immigration laws, and complete many other governance activities. It sounds a little familiar, doesn't it? Tonight, we consider our moment. A new, potentially transformative president attempting to put his stamp on a series of difficult domestic and foreign policy challenges, practicing perhaps a new style of politics and not just the tweets. Our guest is uniquely situated to understand that discussion about politics and that transformation. Mara Liasson began her career as a journalist while earning her degree in history from Brown University. She has spent most of her career at National Public Library. Sorry. I'm a library guy.
It National. Would have been a better idea. Just stay in the library.
At National Public Radio, where she has served in a variety of assignments, including congressional correspondent, White House correspondent, and now national political correspondent. During the Clinton administration, she won the White House Correspondents Association's Merriman Smith Award for daily news coverage 3 separate times. In addition to her work at NPR, Ms. Liasson is a contributor for Fox News Channel and serves as a panelist on Fox News Sunday. So I was out there looking for some interesting biographical information on Mara, and I was struck by how her work at these two very different news organizations suggested what a great journalist she really is. Her work at Fox raises the hackles of some NPR listeners, one of whom argued that she deeply marred NPR's sterling reputation as a reliable source of accurate and unbiased news. Similarly, her work at NPR angers a few Fox listeners who assert she is an Obama-worshipping sycophant. Now, as a professor, I sometimes get criticism from one of my students. And what I realize when that happens is that is, if it's particularly if it's around politics one way or the other, where they're confused by where I stand. To me, that's a great compliment. And I mean both of those as a great compliment to Mara Liasson. Please join me in welcoming her to the USC Price for our George Washington Leadership Lecture Series session on navigating a new reality, politics in the era of Trump. In recent days, President Trump has asserted more than once that millions of people voted illegally in the 2016 election. When you pressed the White House secretary on this issue, they didn't seem to have much of an answer, from my perspective, as to why President Trump continues to hold this belief. Is this an issue, is this really just another alternative fact? Is this a subtle dig at who we are as an American republic? Is this just another news cycle item, or is this something deeper, and how can we imagine it will play out?
Well, it's all of the above, for sure. I just want to say I'm thrilled to be here. I thought hearing about George Washington, that was totally worth flying out here and going back on the red eye for. I mean, that was great because we're in a very first principles moment right now. And we're all, and I have been on a kind of tear about this at home with my kids' schools. Everybody needs to go read the Constitution. And we just had a president sworn in who took the oath of office and never mentioned the Constitution and said in his inaugural address that he took an oath of office to the American people. Really? Actually, he took an oath of office to the Constitution. So we're going to find out in the next 4 years or eight how strong our democratic institutions are. We're going to learn that. It's going to be a big, scary test. And we're going to find out if they are as strong as the founders designed them to be, because they designed them to be bigger than one man. And we live in a republic, a constitutional democracy, and no, it's not just about the ruler and the people and the bond between them. So Donald Trump has a different view of the presidency than any president before him. He's not a constitutional conservative. He's not a little D Democrat. He's not even a little R Republican. So we're going to find that out. But in terms of the question about what we've been dealing with in the last couple of days, this is day five or six, and I like to say this is reality television without the television. You know, okay, it started. And the Trump administration operates on a number of different levels. There's the level of basically what he's been doing, the executive orders, and every new president wants to show their base that they meant what they said, they're going to fulfill their promises. So he's done a whole bunch of things like saying, you know, issuing an order today about the wall, and it might end up being only symbolic or it might not. You know, putting a cap on refugees and cracking down on sanctuary cities. We'll see how all that plays out. Then there's the level of all of the things that he's doing that any conservative, hard right Republican administration would do. In other words, any Republican who's here tonight should be happy because he's going to cut taxes and he's going to slash regulations and he's going to do all the things that any Republican would do. Then there's the other level of kind of Trumpism. And Trumpism means many things. It means kind of a new populist, isolationist, nationalist ideology. But it also means what David is talking about, which is the whole kind of I don't even know what you want to call it, but the stuff that comes from Donald Trump's id, which is all about his sensitivities to the size of his assets, crowds, finances, buildings. He doesn't like to have them questioned. The first kind of distraction that he offered us was about the size of his inauguration crowds, which led him to the second one, which is the whether or not he actually would have won the popular vote. It's all kind of the same thing. He's a real sore winner. He's insecure in his victory, which was stunning and decisive. He didn't win the popular vote, but believe me, he is the president. And as people say, he might have only gotten 46% of the vote, but he has 100% of the power because his party controls the government. So he has said this before about 3 million people voting. Now he's saying 3 to 5 million people voted illegally. He's convinced that he knows that A, that they did, B, that they didn't vote for him. I was thinking, whoa, they voted illegally? Maybe they were in Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. So the reason why this is not funny, you know, you asked is it serious or not, this is really significant. Whether he is sore about the fact that the Women's March was bigger than his crowds, that is not a threat to the Republic, really. That's not going to undermine our democratic institutions. But to say that there was such massive fraud, this, and what I asked at the briefing the other day was, this would be the biggest electoral scandal in American history. This is a fraud of monumental proportions, 3 to 5 million people voting illegally. Certainly he was going to immediately call for an investigation of this, which they didn't plan to, except for today he tweeted that yes, he's going to look into it, and he told David Muir of ABC that he's going to look into it. But the reason why this is so destabilizing is we just had an election where there were ongoing investigations of foreign interference. And now he's raising this idea. Now, I believe that it comes from him and his kind of insecurities about his win and the fact that he still feels he doesn't get enough deference and respect. I don't think, you know, there's a lot of theories about Donald Trump because he's so unusual, but the crazy like a fox theory, that he's really doing this so that Republicans can put in more rules and laws to suppress minority votes, which would go to Democrats. I don't think that's really what he's thinking. That's happening anyway. He doesn't have to say what he did to have all those Republican governors and state legislators all over the country put in voter ID laws. That's happening anyway. But the idea that there was this massive voter fraud. So I just, you know, asked that question. You must want to look into this. And now he says that there will be an investigation. The whole idea of alternative facts, which, as somebody said, alternative facts are what they use in alternatives to democracy. That's what's scary about alternative facts. If facts is just what the ruler says they are, then we don't have a democracy anymore. And that's why it's really important to have the same facts. And yes, I know that we live in an incredibly polarized democracy right now. It preceded Donald Trump. Even the media is polarized. I like to say, you know, I'm the exception that proves the rule, but Fox and MSNBC don't even cover the same natural disasters anymore. And, you know, it really has gotten terrible, and I think this election was another example of it. But, you know, Pew found, I think in a poll last year, that 49% of Republicans and 33% of Democrats said that they would be very sorry if their child married someone of the opposite party. So, you know, we are a divided nation. And what's interesting about Donald Trump is he chose, in his inaugural address, not to reach out beyond his base. He clearly feels that keeping faith with the 30, now he got 46% of the vote, but I think his hardcore base is a little smaller than that. There are plenty of Republicans who voted for him because he was a Republican and they didn't want Hillary Clinton and they wanted lower taxes and fewer regulations, and that's all fine. What I'm interested in as a journalist is what those voters are thinking about him now as they watch him take the most powerful position on the planet. His base is never going to break faith with him, as he said very famously, and I think very accurately. He could stand on Fifth Avenue and shoot someone and he wouldn't lose any votes. But he has chosen not to reach out. And the interesting thing about that address, very dark, very dystopian, real radical departure with other previous inaugural addresses. As Walter Shapiro, a friend of mine and a journalist, quipped, the blowtorch has been passed to a new generation. and it's an old generation, and it's motivated by grievance and nostalgia, not necessarily by optimism about the future. But the picture he painted of drugs, gangs, crime, and education system, he said, flush with cash that deprives our students of all knowledge. I mean, that's pretty much pretty amazing. Carnage, it was very dystopian. I think if you live in a Rust Belt community where the factory has closed and your friends are hooked on opioids, that's a pretty accurate description, but not necessarily shared by the majority of Americans. But, you know, he's chosen not to reach out. And I'll just, you know, I have plenty more to say, but, like, I'll let David come on.
Let's pick up on the inaugural address.
Yeah.
I was really startled by its darkness.
Mm-hmm.
There's, the key line for me, the carnage has to stop.
Right.
It has to stop right now. I mean, carnage. I mean, I understand that the U.S. is a violent society. The U.S. is extraordinary traumatic deaths, you know, in the hundreds of thousands, actually. But this is that doesn't seem to be what he's actually talking about. And so I'm curious about how you thought the address sort of, how did it characterize his view of America?
Well, to me, the most radical part of it, well, he painted this incredibly dark view of America. It was exactly the same as his convention speech. And as he said, only I can fix this. You know, in the convention speech, it was about terrorists coming here, Muslim terrorists coming here, immigrants killing us. You know, he had a whole night devoted to people who'd lost their loved ones in car accidents or other things where an illegal immigrant was at fault. But to me, the most radical thing was when he talked about America's role in the world. And to me, the biggest departure was the isolationism and the end of America as an idea. And the whole idea of America as the leader of the free world, as much of a cliche as that sounds like, is that the idea of America in the world was that we were willing to shoulder more than our fair share because it was in our interest, our national security interest, our economic interest, to have a rules-based world order where liberal democracies were seen as the most stable and the way the way to provide for the most prosperity and the most security for the most people. And that he offered this vision that he said, from now on, it's going to be only America first. That was just, to me, extraordinary, especially because I think right before that or right after that, he'd given that interview to the London Times where he said NATO was obsolete. The EU is just a vehicle for Germany. It doesn't matter to the US whether the EU breaks up or not. And as a matter of fact, he kind of approvingly talked about it breaking up. That's America's second biggest trading partner. And also all of the incredible lavish admiration and praise he has offered to Vladimir Putin. I mean, that is a huge, huge departure. And that and inside the United States, we're waiting to see what he does as opposed to what he says. But around the world, what he says is what matters. Now, I know in Washington, a lot of people are clinging to the idea that James Mattis disagrees with him. James Mattis, the defense secretary, thinks that NATO is the most important institution and so necessary that if it didn't exist, we'd have to create it. Okay, so they're hoping that his view prevails. Donald Trump is the president of the United States, and he just told the world, you're on your own, suckers. And the only value he stood for, didn't mention any democratic values, nothing about kind of freedom of speech or human rights or even free market capitalism. It's just about winning. We've got to make better deals for ourselves. And he said, other countries are ravaging our borders, stealing our jobs, stealing our companies. I mean, and it's going to stop. I mean, that is an extraordinary kind of cramped and transactional view for the greatest democratic superpower the world has ever known. So that was, to me, that's the biggest departure. What he does inside the United States really remains to be seen. He might just have a kind of brazen, rough, slightly crude way of talking about things, but govern as a typical conservative, you know, very conservative Republican president. Maybe. We don't know yet.
So many things. But let's stick to the foreign policy. I think that most people agree that the United States has had a pretty consistent policy around Russia for at least 70 years, I would actually argue since late 1921, which is a long time ago. This seems to be a symbolic example of how he just wants to blow it all up. And I understand that he feels an affinity to Mr. Putin. I understand that, but in some sense, aren't there going to be people around him who are going to say,
look, this is the theory. The theory is that Mike Pence and James Mattis and Reince Priebus are going to somehow manage him. And, you know, the big question now in Washington is, who's going to co-opt who? Is he going to be co-opted by traditional Republicans, people like John McCain, who are saying, you know, we're going to draw some lines? If he tries to lift the sanctions on Russia, I think he will get pushback from Congress. The one thing that's interesting about Donald Trump, even though he represents such a departure, he is a populist, nationalist, isolationist, protectionist president. That is really different. Of all of the kind of institutions that he has challenged, and he has obliterated the conservative movement and the traditional Republican ideology. But where does this new thing that he's offering take root? He's got his hardcore 38% of voters. That's who he really has. But who's his faction in Washington? There's not a movement in Congress. He has found support among some Tea Party, Rust Belt Republicans who certainly agree with him on trade and immigration. But that's normal. That's within the normal bounds. But to the isolationist kind of feeling that we should just go back to an era of great powers, and that he feels that Vladimir Putin is on par with Angela Merkel as an ally for the United States. I mean, that's just extraordinary. Now, is it just because he has an affinity for populist authoritarian strongmen because that's his leadership style? Or, there was of course all that speculation, was he somehow compromised? And that's what the whole, you know, investigation into Russian interference in the election. We still don't know the answer to that. You know, we had the unverifiable dossier which came out. We don't know why he has been. Donald Trump is an extremely inconsistent person. On one issue, he has been utterly 100% that's consistent, amazing. And that's Vladimir Putin. He has never, ever uttered a single, you know, negative thing or critical thing about Putin. And he's talked about, you know, getting rid of the sanctions in exchange for some kind of nuclear weapons deal. Well, the day before that, he said he wanted to increase, expand, and modernize our nuclear arsenal. So he is the great deal maker. Now, that's another thing. He's the great deal maker. That's his persona and brand. He's going to be making some deals, and let's see how good they are. Yeah. Because I don't think he knows yet how much leverage other countries have. We're in a period where American power was already diminishing because we were in a multipolar world. We were still the greatest superpower and the only democratic one. But, you know, what happens when he tries to make a deal with China? You know, he kind of flirted with the idea that he was going to get rid of the One China policy. Or was he really saying the One China policy was just a bargain, that Taiwan was just a bargaining chip, right, you know, to be thrown over? So we're going to find out about that. But I do think, even though he has busted through so many norms and overturned so many conventions and stretched, you know, the kind of democratic civic conventions, in the end, I think he actually will be judged by an extremely traditional, old-fashioned metric, which is, at the end of 4 years, are there more jobs? Do people feel more safe? You know, do they feel better off than they were 4 years ago? Now, he's in a strong position. His party controls both houses of Congress, and presidents in their first year, regardless of whether they're popular or not, if they control all of Congress, they get their agenda through. That's just what happens. And he's inheriting the strongest economy that any president, incoming president, has inherited in 20 years. He's the first president in 20 years to come in when unemployment is dropping and GDP growth is going up. So he's got a pretty strong hand. He could actually do nothing and he'd be in great shape. The question is will he do things that will put growth on steroids, get to the 4 or 5% that he says he wants to get to, or will he start a trade war with China and blow everything up? We don't know. He doesn't either. I feel very strong about
predicting the future is a difficult thing. Let's go back to this, Trump as, again, to the speech a little bit, but even beyond that. In some sense, he is a populist leader and has portrayed himself as that.
Mm-hmm.
And if we look back through American history, populist leaders are very popular, but they don't tend to win. And it's not that typical for an extraordinary sort of outside the political parties, as you suggest. One could make an argument that he's blown up the Republican Party, the conservative movement. And so I think many of us looking at him, hearing him in the inaugural address, say January 22nd, 2017, will be remembered as the day the people became rulers of this nation again. Is it rhetoric? Is it real? How does he get his populism taken from campaign rhetoric to policy?
Well, that's a really, really good question, because he is the kind of populist leader that never gets the nomination, let alone wins the presidency. I mean, Bill Kristol said the night of his Trump's convention speech, he says, "Wow, it's Pat Buchanan's convention speech updated and delivered by the nominee." That was the big difference. He comes from a particular kind of populism. It's a xenophobic, isolationist, right, protectionist populism. Because there's been left-wing populism too. But anyway, how does he make it reality? That is an excellent question. Right now, you would have to say he has a faux populist cabinet. A lot of billionaire CEOs. His agenda, to the extent that the stuff that he is going to pass and sign right away, is a traditional conservative Republican agenda, although he says, and his Treasury Secretary said, there isn't going to be an absolute tax cut for the wealthy. We'll see. It looks pretty skewed to the upper income brackets. Is it really going to help all of those white working class people who he knows is his base? And everything he did in the first day was to keep faith with them. He had the labor leaders come in. He's made a big deal about every individual job that he's saved, So he knows who brung him, he knows who brung him. But in order to actually make this stuff into reality, he has to grow his base. He has to go from, being a 46% president with a 40% approval rating, which is extraordinary. Now, I'm not saying that's going to make him an unsuccessful president, because like I said, first-term presidents with complete control of Congress, whether they're unpopular or not, get their agenda through. But it means something that he's at 40%, which is the lowest approval rating of any president. He needs to expand his base. And Steve Bannon, who's his kind of ideological, strategist guru, believes that you start with this white working class base and then you pass a $1 trillion infrastructure program and you get Hispanics and African Americans who are going to work on all these bridges and tunnels to vote for you because you're going to boost economic growth. That's the theory. Can you do that, having run the kind of nativist campaign he has done? We don't know. Is this like Prop 187? Because Pete Wilson won. The damage came later to the Republican Party in California. In other words, so we don't know if that's what we're witnessing or not. But he has to govern successfully. Many of the old political laws of gravity don't apply to him, but I don't think that he has abolished every single one of them.
It is fascinating to me he wants to drain the swamp, but he brings billionaires in. There's just so many contradictions in how he appears and what he seems to be doing. I guess I would ask you, do we have a real sense of what first-year presidents, they got Congress, they get their agenda done. What's the agenda?
Well, that's a great question. The stuff that he's going to get passed for sure is the agenda basically adopted the Republican congressional agenda, cutting taxes, cutting regulations, doing something about Obamacare. But that is a perilous thing because it will become Trump care really soon. And, the Republicans have some choices. They could change a few paragraphs, call it Trump care, and then everyone will love it. Or they can obliterate it and or not be able to replace it with anything and have people lose their insurance and then they get blamed for it. But what is his agenda? The one agenda item that he talked about in the inaugural address, he didn't talk about the wall, he didn't talk about Obamacare, he didn't talk about immigration, he talked about infrastructure. That's the one thing he talked about. that was the unifying thing. In other words, that is the thing that has bipartisan support, and it makes sense, and you can't export jobs building an American bridge. You know, so that's, or a tunnel. So the big question is, that's where the Republicans in Congress don't, they're not with him on that. $1 trillion of infrastructure, that's the kind of thing they rejected when Obama proposed it. You know, I don't even know what they call it. That's just government spending. You know, and what's really interesting to me in Washington is that the Republican Party used to say they had principles. They were against deficit spending. They were for free trade, immigration, but those are just policy shifts, and they've come over to his side on that. But to say that deficits only matter if there's a Democratic president, crony capitalism only matters if there's a Democratic president, corruption only matters if there's a Democratic president, that's an extraordinary thing for a party to go through. You know, to think about, just to do the thought experiment, what if Hillary Clinton continued her foundation? You know, I'm trying to think of something equivalent to the Trump Organization. You know, what if she... went out and praised individual companies over another, said that Fox is doing better than CNN, you know, inserted herself into the free market, they would be, you know, impeachment articles would be being drawn up. And what Mar-a-Lago in Florida has just doubled its membership fee. There are now going to be apparently many, many more Trump hotels built in the United States. Every day, Donald Trump cashes a check, you know, from the profits from his businesses. He's not running them, and there's some kind of trust that's supposedly set up, but he is continuing to get all of the income, you know, that he is due from them. So that's an extraordinary thing, and the Republican Party seems to not think that's an issue at all. That's a big change in American politics.
I grew up in a Republican household. When I was 10 years old, my dad had me out handing flyers for Barry Goldwater. Yeah. And so this is my life at some level for a long time. And I just, you know, the Republicans, the conservative Republicans that have come of age in the last, under Reagan, they must be going nuts.
They are, but it's so complicated. First of all, this is what they've wanted. They just needed a Republican in the White House. They can get their agenda through now. Now, I think they think that they can manage him, you know, and that Mitch McConnell has been pretty clear about a number of things, that he's just not going to go there. And there are many things that Trump will need 60 votes for.
Right.
You know, and that's going to be including the Supreme Court justice that he's going to nominate next week.
Right.
So at some point, he's going to have to reach out. And how will he do that? And we already know that he's more extroverted and social, and he certainly is going to have members up to the White House more than Obama did. But is that going to be enough or not?
We're going to find out.
Yeah, we'll find out.
You raised two issues that I want to spend some time on, and one of them is his relationship to business. In some sense, there's this... this, again, contradiction, because he wants to lower taxes, he wants to have business reap many benefits, and yet he's also threatened companies regularly. He's suggested that if they take jobs out, we're going to have new tariffs on their goods. I couldn't help remembering when we had the debate about immigration under Ronald Reagan, and Ronald Reagan thought he could balance We're gonna fix the supply side by making citizenship, and we're gonna penalize business for hiring anyone who wasn't a citizen. And we fixed the supply side, and business went, oh no, you're not gonna do that. And so the question is, are we once again gonna see this lots of goodies for business, but there's not gonna be any payment? Or is he that exceptional president who believes that, again, to his base, this is critical for him to hold them?
I think he's different in that respect. I mean, when he says that, you know, first of all, he certainly believes in jawboning, and he's made some small successes in that. And you got to give him credit for that. You know, I don't think it makes a big difference in the jobs picture. It doesn't move the needle very much, but, you know, and he'll always claim credit for a little bit more than he actually got, or a lot more. You know, so he saved 700 jobs, you know, in Indiana. And of course, Carrier now says, you know, it's going to put in, what is it, $16 million in investment into the plant, and it's going to automate it. And you know, that's my next question. You know, I've had a lot of fun this week at the briefings. I don't know how many of you are political junkies enough to watch, but the first day I just asked, what is the unemployment rate? I just wanted to know what they would say. The second day we got into the thing about the 3 million votes. But what I'm dying to ask them is, what is his plan about robots? Because automation and technology is responsible for so much more of the job loss in manufacturing than trade or than foreign competition. And what's really interesting is I think we've lost something like some unbelievable amount of manufacturing jobs, you know, 84% in the last 30 years. But the output, the actual efficiency has gone up just as much because we can produce so much more with fewer people. And that's what's happening. And of course, Andy Puzder, you know, the labor nominee who said famously, you know, he loves the idea of automating fast food because robots don't slip and fall. They don't show up late. I forget, he had a whole list of things that robots don't do, you know. But I think that breaks. Donald Trump will govern as a populist. I think he will try. He is beholden to no one. You know, that's his great strength. When he had the business leaders up on the first day, you know, he told them, look, we're going to slash regulations, we're going to cut taxes, you're going to be very happy, but if you move your plant to Mexico and you fire all your workers and then you try to import your goods back into this country, I'm going to put a big tariff on you. Now, big question about that. We know he's threatening that. You know, can he do that? Is he going to disadvantage an American company with a plant in Mexico, but he's going to let BMW import the cars from Mexico to the United States? It's very complicated. We don't know if he can slap tariffs on individual companies, if he needs congressional approval. I don't know how much support he's going to get in Congress for that. What we're waiting for is when the first big difference between him and the Republicans in Congress, you know, comes up, what kind of leverage does he have? We know that Steve Bannon, you know, really has it in for Paul Ryan. You know, when he ran Breitbart, you know, very famously said, Paul Ryan will be gone by the spring, you know, and that didn't happen. But I don't know exactly what leverage he will have with his own party when they decide not to be with him. So that's what we're waiting for. But I do think he's going to try. I don't think he's going to be just a traditional kind of pro-corporate, pro-business community Republican president. He knows that the working class vote was his base, and he's going to try to keep faith with them.
Do you have a sense of where that congressional leadership is? Is it just trying to figure out what to do? Is there a sense that they know they have an agenda, they're moving, and that they don't care if it matches his?
Well, they have first of all, they're trying hard to get their agenda and his on the same page. But yeah, they have an agenda, and so far he's embraced it in terms of cutting taxes and regulations and doing something about Obamacare. You know, repealing and replacing Obamacare is like it's TBD. You know, it's a line item, but it has no detail yet, and that's going to be very hard. But yeah, they have an agenda. There's some things they're not crazy about that he wants to do, like $1 trillion worth of infrastructure.
Right. You would think that
tariffs.
Isn't there those guys and gals called deficit hawks?
Well, that's really interesting because Mick Mulvaney, who's the OMB nominee, he is a deficit hawk. And in his hearings, he has not backed away from that. And what happens when all those things Donald Trump wants to do are not paid for? The budget that has been floating around doesn't come anywhere near to paying for it. You know, getting rid of the NEA is not going to help you.
No. We don't want to get rid of the NEA in my house.
Yeah.
Let's turn just a little back to some of the things. Sorry, I had a second one that came up when you were talking, and that was, where are the Democrats?
Ah, good question. Okay, well, there are a lot of Democrats out there on Saturday. I mean, where are the Democrats? They were out there wearing pink pussy hats. However, okay, so here's my little spiel about the Democrats. Okay, so we've gone from the conventional wisdom being that the demographic changes are, you know, destiny for Democrats. New conventional wisdom, Democrats are inefficiently distributed around the country. So that's kind of where we're at. You know, and I think, you know, Tom Steyer and George Soros has to start the, what I call the Millennial Homesteading Project, where they offer subsidies to young people to move out of New York and California and go to move to swing states. And you don't have to live in a rural town. You can live in Philadelphia or Ann Arbor or Madison or something. Anyway, there are a lot of good restaurants in swing states. You can get, you know, and there are even tattoo parlors in swing states. But anyway, so that's okay. So the Democrats, I did a story during the campaign about how the Democrats have so much more at stake in this election than Republicans did, because without the White House, they're nowhere. Guess what? Now they're nowhere. And President Obama, for all of his successes, presided over more losses of elected offices for his party than any other president in American history. So the Democrats are really at their nadir. And they have to start building from ground zero. And, you know, Barack Obama and Eric Holder are starting this, redistricting project. Finally, after 8 years of not paying attention to down-ballot races, now that he's out of office, he's going to try to get Democrats elected to down-ballot races so they can have some kind of say in redistricting after the next census, which was, of course, the Republicans' great stroke of luck, is that their great surge happened in 2010, which was a decennial year, and then they got to draw the boundaries that kept them in power for the next 10 years. The Democrats' surge in 06 and 08 didn't really help them that much because it wasn't, a redistricting year. But in terms of the march and Democrats and all that, So my only disappointment, of course, I did not march and could not march because I'm an objective journalist. I wanted every one of those women with the hat to also be waving a flag. Why didn't they all have an American flag? And that, I think the Democrats have to figure out what exactly are they about. If this truly is a first principles moment, then they have to start talking about what being an American means, how it's different than Donald Trump has defined it. What is nationalism to the Democratic Party? Usually we thought of in America, nationalism was about shared values, not about ethnicity. So I think that the Democrats have to have a much broader definition about the American values and democratic values. I don't think the march, which was very impressive in its numbers, the march really wasn't just about Planned Parenthood, or it wasn't, or Black Lives Matter. The march was about just saying, no, this is not okay. And Donald Trump equals America. His definition of what it means to be an American is not ours. So I think that they have to take all that energy and all those people and do something like the Tea Party did. The two models are Occupy Wall Street or the Tea Party. You don't want to be Occupy Wall Street because they kind of fizzled and had no effect on any electoral politics that I could see, except for maybe they went out and voted for Jill Stein and Gary Johnson. That was really helpful to Democrats. Or they can be the Tea Party, which stayed inside the tent of the Republican Party. It did not become a third party. It was like an energy source, a big jolt of energy for the Republicans. And we'll see what happens in 2018. And 2018, they're geographically disadvantaged because so many of those Democratic senators are in red states. But they have to start, all those people who are marching have to start running for office. Dog catcher, city council, state legislature. They have to show up in midterm elections. Republicans turn out their voters every 2 years, and Democrats, for some reason, only turn out their voters every 4 years. I mean, that has been the kind of congenital problem for Democratic voters. And right now, the Democratic Party doesn't have a single leader. I think that's fine. I don't think that's necessary. I think that, Democrats have to organize. They have to, pick some fights in Congress. I mean, Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi are not going to be the kind of figurehead. They're not going to be the leaders of the party and of the future of the Democratic Party, but they are very, very able, and it is easier to be the opposition in Washington. It's easier to oppose than to get things passed, as we saw all throughout the Obama years. So, they have to just pick themselves off the floor and figure out how they're going to come back, and it might take a long time. But just as Obama was a galvanizing force for the right, Donald Trump, I think, is that on steroids for the left.
So you have said in the past that Democrats need to get a clear economic message and rebuild their leadership pipeline. But do you have a sense that in this Congress, are there a few people or outside the Congress, can the Women's March lead to a group of women or others who would emerge as Democratic leadership that's, you know, in some sense, you know, anytime you have an 8-year presidency, the president's been the leader for a very long time, there's a vacuum, a void. Are there? Yes, I think there are.
And I don't think that the void was just because they had a Democratic president for 8 years. The Democrats had a kind of horrible problem that their leadership was so old, other than Obama. This is a party that won 2/3 of the youth vote, had incredible structural advantages, demographic advantages, and look who ran for office. Hillary Clinton was whatever, 69, you know, Bernie Sanders was 72, and Joe Biden, who could have run. I mean, that's just insane. Well, that's because their pipeline was decimated in 2010 and 14. Right. I think that's why they have no leaders, not so much that Barack Obama was in office for 8 years. And also, you know, you've had in the Congress, you've had the same people, you know, like Nancy Pelosi, who I think is very, very able, but you know, there hasn't been a new generation coming up. There will be. I think there are plenty of them out there, whether it's Kirsten Gillibrand or Amy Klobuchar or Kamala Harris or Cory Booker or John Hickenlooper. I mean, they're out there. And nobody knew who Barack Obama was until he gave that big speech in Boston. So that will happen. And I don't think that's as important as getting an economic message, which Hillary Clinton did not have, coming up with an effective way to communicate to Rust Belt communities every single day. So how's it working out for you? How's that America First thing working out for you? Just like the Republicans said all the time, how's that hope and change thing working out for you? You know, they need to be communicating to the people who used to be the Democrats' base and are now Trump's base, you know, has he brought your factory job back yet or not?
I want to switch it a little bit. We're going to open this up to questions from the audience in about 5 or 10 minutes. But before we do, I have a couple more questions. And one of them is, I've read several of your stories. I've looked at some videos online. And one of the things that I really have enjoyed learning about you is your concern about American civic education. And so this last election, and in recent years, we've seen regional split, rural-urban split, a sense of the civic literacy at a very low ebb. Provocatively, should we be worrying as much about civic education as we seem to be worrying about education in science and technology?
Yes, even more, I would say. This is my thing. I mean, I've been into my kids' school to talk to the principal, and like, there, yes, what? Nobody even knows what the Constitution is. Nobody's going to even know when their rights disappear if you don't even know what they are in the first place. I mean, yes, we should be having civic literacy. Yes, and I think it's really important, and I think there's such an incredible opportunity for schools, I mean, at every single level, to not only educate people about what American democracy is about. No, it's not just about voting. You know, what is liberal democracy? What does it mean? And right alongside that, you teach how you can tell a fake news story from a non-fake news story. To me, it's almost one and the same thing. Because if you're an informed citizenry, you should be able to tell the difference. And right. and it is possible to do that. So yeah, I think that's a real big problem. You know, and hopefully schools, I keep on coming back to this. This is such a first principles moment. This is a chance for us to really reconnect. If we want to save, if people think that somehow Trump threatens democratic values, and he might or might not, then this is a great opportunity to start, you know, reinvesting in them.
So I have to, so you're welcome to clap. I believe that too. I have to ask about the post-truth, alternative fact, fake news world that we live in. Is there anything we can do about this?
Yes, of course there is. Of course there is. It seems so overwhelming. It's because it happened in real time and we didn't really realize it was happening. Yes, of course it is. Okay, but let's separate out those things. Fake news was an actual thing in the campaign. people putting up websites with lots of false stories, blah, blah, blah. Then it became an epithet. Ooh, fake news, meaning you're saying something I don't agree with, you know. Okay, fake news is a real thing. It's either, you know, Russian-backed websites or kids in Macedonia peddling stuff about Hillary Clinton. That's one thing. But then there's alternative facts. That's something different. That's when Donald Trump stands up and says 3 million people voted illegally, or my crowds are bigger than yours, and don't believe your lying eyes, you know, or what's the phrase? Who are you going to believe, me or your lying eyes?
Yeah.
That is a different problem. And that's something that's where, you know, journalists come in, and, you know, we have to call that out for what it is. And you're not entitled to your own facts. And you are entitled to your own opinions. And it's interesting, at one point, Sean Spicer in the briefing said something like, well, I just mean that you can say that today is cloudy with a chance of rain, or it's rainy. Well, no, that's really not the kind of distinction we're talking about. Either 5 million people voted illegally, or they didn't.
Right.
And if they did, that means our democracy has been completely and totally undermined. So I think the alternate facts, which seems to have cut through, by the way, and become not just a meme, but apparently I've been told that on the Jumbotron at all sorts of sports events over the weekend, people put up, you know, there are now 1.5 million people in this arena, you know, at Spicer Facts or something. So, but that's something really significant, and people have to stand up for that, and I think they are, and people have to just get up, stand up on their hind legs, and insist on the facts. Some things are disputable, some things are not.
Right. So, two last questions. I realize we just inaugurated a president, started a new Congress, but shouldn't we start talking about 2018?
Well, look.
Or 2020?
Well, you know, look, 2018, like I said, is going to be it's geographically disadvantaged for Democrats because so many of the senators who are up in 2018 are from red states, but they're people like, you know, John Tester or Heidi Heitkamp or Manchin, who's, I'm blanking on his first name right now. I'm just Joe Manchin. Thank you. Newsheimer's moment. Who know how to win in their states. But it's a really good year, just the luck of the draw for Republicans in the Senate. I think that Democrats could pick up some House seats. Usually that happens in the first midterm of a new president. So 2018 is not a great year for Democrats the way that 2010 was for Republicans. That was an incredible historic surge. You know, they took the House back, and 2020, like, I can't even think that far. You know, to me, and I think it's almost a waste of time to think that far, because there's so much that's gonna happen in the interim, and there's so much basic, as I said, kind of first principles work that has to be done. You know, I can't even think that far.
Okay. I will point out that I've heard you say and others say that a president with a very low rating and surprisingly unified Congresses don't necessarily do well in the midterm elections as people in unified Congresses would think they would. But in some sense that those two things don't have to be as good for that election because there's so much expectation upon them.
Yes, and we don't know if you know, a lot of the rules didn't apply to Donald Trump during this campaign. At some point, they're going to start working again, maybe. You know, he did win election with 66% of Americans saying he wasn't qualified. So maybe his takeaway is, so what if I have 40% approval rating? You know, doesn't matter. I'll still win. What was so interesting about this election is I said the old conventional wisdom was that the Democrats were going to be protected by demographic changes. The new conventional wisdom is Democrats are inefficiently distributed. The theory was that demography and the fact that the electorate was getting younger and browner was good for Democrats. There was a small group of Republicans, not the mainstream. The mainstream felt, whoa, we got to learn how to reach out to Hispanics. We've got to pass comprehensive immigration reform. That's what Reince Priebus's autopsy report in 2013 was all about. There was a small group of Republicans who said, you know what? we can still eke out one more victory with the white vote. Just one more. You know, yes, the electorate is getting less and less proportionally white, but it's not there yet. And Donald Trump tested that theory, and he put it on steroids, and he got white people, particularly white working class people, to vote like a minority group. Right. In other words, so he took identity politics, and this is a lesson to me for the left. He said, oh, identity politics? I'll call your identity politics. White identity politics beats any other kind of identity politics, I can tell you that. And that's what he did. And I don't know if he can do it again, but he did it. You know, to get 69% of the, you know, white non-college voters or whatever it is he did, that's extraordinary. They voted like a minority group.
Right.
So, you know, I don't know if that's something that he can do again in 2020. I don't know. I think that he has to have some real deliverables for those people. But what we all, but also the other big mystery to me as a political journalist, okay, what are the things that his base voters feel he has to deliver on, and what are the things that he could do or not do that would make them feel betrayed? We don't know that. Right. I think they're willing to cut him a lot of slack. President's base voters usually do. He's trying. You know, at least he's trying. You know, that's the question.
So my last question is, what predictions would you give us about what we might be surprised by a Trump presidency, good or bad?
Whoa, it's so hard to make predictions, especially about the future. all right, let's see. Something that I might be surprised.
But it's so much fun to
do. Okay, I guess the thing that I already am surprised about, so that's easy to predict, is there's no pivot, no pivot. There's no secret presidential Donald Trump that's going to come out after he's president. No, what you see is what you get. 70-year-old man doesn't change his spots. This is it. So that's the surprise, is he's not changing. Okay, that's one. Now, that's good or bad, depending on your point of view. And other surprises, boy, I think that... I guess the surprise is that he won't be as much a captive of conventional Republicans as they think he might be.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly what form that takes. But that's what I would guess. I think he's very serious about doing something different, and he ran as much against the leadership of his own party as he did anything else. And I think the way he ran almost destroyed his ability to do something that he could have done, which would have been amazing, which is if he hadn't run on such a xenophobic nativist platform, he could have reached across the aisle and formed this incredible cross-partisan, nonpartisan coalition on entitlements, on Medicare, you know, bargaining with the drug companies for Medicare, on infrastructure. You know, there's so many things that he did transcend partisan boundaries, right. But because he ran, he had so much racial rhetoric, he had so much, you know, those things you can't really get over. That's the Prop 187 model, which is Pete Wilson did use it to get reelected, but after that he obliterated the Republican Party in California. You know,
for people who don't know,
maybe you were all too young.
Yeah, after that election,
Do you know what Prop 187 was here in California?
Voter registration skyrocketed.
It was an anti-immigration referendum. He wrote it. He used it to win re-election. But after that, like, you know, Hispanics just totally, totally rejected the Republican Party. Yeah. And, you know, and that's why California is the blue state it is today. What year was that? Like 80-something.
94.
Oh, 94. Okay. 94. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, anyway.
It wasn't 80. That's a difference.
Yeah, 94.
So there were a bunch of Republican intellectuals and conservative intellectuals like Raihan Salam and Ross Douthat and David Frum, who for the longest time, for months before the election, after Trump got the nomination, were thinking, oh my God, this is going to be 1964. The Democrats are going to wipe us out nationally. But that's good. That's good for the future of conservatism,
right.
Because we'll be able to reform it.
Right.
Those are the classic reform conservatives who I happen to be a big fan of. Then we woke up on November 9th and everything was different. And so my question for you, and I really like a lot of your analysis, by the way, it's very spot on. My question is that collapse still coming? Is the Ryan Congress and the Trump administration going to overreach itself or go get into scandal and stuff like that to the degree that that collapse might come and that opportunity to have to reformulate the right come for the Republicans again? Or is it strong enough as it is right now, and is American politics in a state where there's really just going to be kind of Reaganite conservatism evolving and Trump conservatism kind of thrashing around in the near future?
Well, first of all, I don't know. But second of all, I don't think it's Reaganite. I don't think it's, wait, I think that Reaganite conservatism right now is in total eclipse. I think that the whole concept, which everybody was expecting, I had my piece already written that I was going to have the day after election, that it would be Republicans in the wilderness, it would be conservatives having to go back to first principles. Instead, what Trump is offering is that the Republican Party should be a nativist, protectionist, kind of crony capitalist party, all things that make conservative intellectuals, you know, just tear their hair out, and that he's promising this kind of marriage of, you know, big corporations and white working class. I don't know how that marriage works out. I really don't. Because protectionism is not good for corporate America. And that's still a big part of the Republican coalition. And, you know, even building a wall isn't good for corporate America. So the idea of a, but he gets to define what being a Republican is now, and it's a real nationalist, populist thing. I think there's, you know, you listed some of the conservative intellectuals. There are plenty more of them who don't believe in crony capitalism, who think that corruption of this on the scale that Donald Trump is practicing it, even if it's not illegal, is still bad and is going to kind of warp the soul of a party. And the whole idea that if they had been cast into the wilderness, it would have been better because they would have had this chance at a fresh start. I think the answer to your question, just we have to wait to see what happens to Trump. If he crashes and burns, yes, there's going to be a chance to do that. It's very hard for me to imagine what is a truly Trumpian party that is a majority party. In other words, it was just such a, yep. I don't want to say he's an accidental president because if he was listening now, he would say that I'm questioning his legitimacy, which I am not. But what I'm saying is if it wasn't for Gary Johnson, Jill Stein, Vladimir Putin, James Comey, and 77,000 votes in Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania, we would be having the conversation you just suggested. So anyway, I'm sorry. I don't have a better answer than that.
Traditionally, the print press, the New York Times, Washington Post, has set the agenda often for the press corps in the White House for the day. I'm wondering how Twitter is now changing that with information coming out 24/7 directly from the president. How is that changing?
Are you kidding? That's changing it a lot. Look, every president uses whatever is the latest media tool that has happening. You know, every president does things differently. Bill Clinton, you know, went on late night talk shows and famously said, had televised town hall meetings and would say famously, see, I can get around the press. You know, every president does that. So Donald Trump has Twitter. You know, he's dominated social media. You know, he's figured out how to do that. Now that he's the president, that is the way he communicates with the public so that when he tweets something, it does matter, especially when he says something that is significant, like comparing the intelligence community to Nazi Germany, or to saying, you know, that Fox is better than CNN. I mean, or to saying, oh, or to tweeting about a local labor union leader in Indiana and, you know, having the guy have to leave his house because of death threats. I mean, he can send stock prices up or down. He can make individual people's lives miserable, and he does not believe in, why don't you pick on someone your own size? He doesn't believe on that. So that does matter, and yes, we all, like, read Twitter and see what he says, and that definitely, that's just the same thing as the president going into the East Room and delivering remarks. Same thing.
Let's go over
Hello.
Here.
What is happening with the Emoluments Clause? And I know some constitutional lawyers have put forth some briefs, thank goodness, but there doesn't seem to be a lot of legal standing. So what is your thought on that process, because if that is disregarded by the court, there are so many conflicts of interest.
Right.
Is that legitimate, alternative facts?
Like I don't know like what's going to happen to this. Is two former ethics officials, one Republican and one Democrat, who have brought this suit, Norm Eisen and Richard Painter. And I don't know where that's going to go. I don't know. I think in terms of the emoluments clause, I don't really, I'm not a legal scholar. I don't really know all the ins and outs of standing. But I do know that there is an effort around the country in law firms and lots of nonprofits, including the ACLU, that every single one of Donald Trump, of the Trump organization's competitors, will be solicited as a client, as a plaintiff, for hundreds and hundreds of lawsuits, because you know, those are the entities that I would think would have standing. I mean, if you're a hotel in Washington, you know, you can't compete with the President of the United States. Also, what about the GSA? I mean, the conflicts are so complicated and myriad that your head explodes. He's now leasing the Trump Hotel from the GSA, and there is a clause in that lease that says, you know, you can't do that if you're a government official. Now, of course, he'll say, oh, I'm not, it's my son's. Well, wait a second, you still own the company because you didn't divest. There are going to be a lot of lawsuits. When that actually comes to fruition, also, there's going to be another, there's already David Brock, who's a Democratic activist, pro-Hillary person who has a lot of groups. He's going to start something like Judicial Watch. In other words, the right-wing group that sued for documents and had FOIA requests and was constantly trying to uncover various scandals for Hillary Clinton, the same thing will happen for Donald Trump. Now, will it matter? He certainly has no shame. In other words, it doesn't really matter to Republicans anymore. That kind of corruption and conflicts don't matter to Republicans, and they're the ones who control Congress. But there will be a lot of lawsuits, a lot of lawsuits.
Hi. First of all, I've watched you for a long time, and I love your journalism.
Thank you.
That being said, I am diametrically opposed to most of what you, your positions. Couple of things I wanted to, but I say that with the greatest
thanks.
Respect.
I appreciate it.
You know, this is what we do here. We talk and we discuss, and that's what makes America. So one thing, I had a conversation with John Kasich, and he was in the cabinet room of the White House when they were talking to the president and different people about the offshore money, the taxes, estimating $2.5 to maybe even $4 trillion. And when they asked the president about that, at least John told me this, they said, well, why would we do that? They might bring it back and pay dividends. And
wait, the president said that?
Yes, the president said that to John Kasich.
Would we do that?
Because they might bring that money back in the country and dividends would be paid.
And why would that be bad? Wait.
Well, I don't know. That's
I thought that was one of the bedrock principles of the tax reform bill that they're trying to write right now.
No, they are getting, now. No, I'm talking about President Obama.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Trump.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
So you've got that. Then it was released this week also that regulation probably cost the country 20 years ago $300 billion a year. It's costing us $2 trillion a year now. So if somehow that they manage to do that and you have an influx of $2.5 trillion and maybe another $1.5 trillion in regulations, what does that do to the economy? So
I think that Republicans and the Trump administration feel that would be a great boost to economic growth. That's why they want to do it.
Right.
I mean, that kind of corporate tax reform, repatriating all that money, you know, bringing it back to the country, is something that they've wanted to do for a long time.
Right. And then finally, you know the old adage, if you say something long enough, people will believe it. And I kept wondering during the campaign, because the president would look at the back and say, those are the liars there, those are. And I thought he must be crazy, because the media, I thought, was against him anyway, coming from my perspective. And then as things evolved, and after the election, I thought, no, what he did was, and I want your comment about this, if you thought this was coming. After he did this, what he did was he was defining the media, branding you. And so when the WikiLeaks came And when the Boston Globe stories and the New York Times and the Donna Brazile and the Washington Post and the CNN stories about feeding Hillary questions, by that time, the people who were had a tendency to lean toward him, or even the undecideds, then were thinking, well, we can't trust the media. We can't trust them at all. So no matter what they say about this man, well, I'm asking you, did you see that coming? Did any of you see that
coming? Sure, we saw it as it was happening. There's no doubt, look, every candidate, especially Republicans, run against the mainstream media. He did it to a much bigger degree. Plus, you already had a loss, lack of trust in every institution in America, including the media. But he singled us out. He made us his foil, no doubt about it. And I think he was successful at it. And then when you have, you know, Russia feeding stuff to WikiLeaks, all that contributed. All that helped him. No doubt about it. No doubt about it. All we can do, and I just want to make really clear when people talk about the media is not one thing. We're not a monolith. We don't get up in the morning and have a meeting and decide what we're going to do. But each of us just has to try to do the best job we can. And, you know, which is try to present the facts as we can ferret them out and explain what they mean. And I think that it was sometimes at those rallies, it's one thing for him to stand up and say, oh, dishonest people, scum of the earth. It's another thing when you're standing there in the pen and you see the Trump supporters with those T-shirts, rope, tree, journalist, some assembly required. I mean, you know.
Thanks. I think the question that really the march raised for me was really how do we work in this age to protect democracy and the issues that we care about? And frankly, I kind of want to put the caveat, what's the busy person's guide to that?
The busy person's guide to that is you have to vote first and foremost. If you want to and have the time, you should run for office, number two. Number three, you should actually work for candidates that you believe in. And just, you could never get any data on this, but I really wondered how many people who marched either didn't vote or voted for Gary Johnson or Jill Stein. Or here's a little factoid that I heard Jennifer Granholm describe, that in Michigan, either 45,000 or 75,000 straight Democratic ballots left the top line blank, which is way more than she lost by. So, so all those things are the busy person's guide. You don't have to spend hours and hours in meetings, and you don't even have to march every weekend, but you have to be engaged. And this is where I feel that, Democrats really have to take responsibility for what happened. As I said before, Republican voters get their vote out. Republican voters vote every 2 years. Democrats generally vote every 4 years. That's just irresponsible.
This was an extraordinary evening. I really want to thank David and Mara and Doug for their presentations. It's really been wonderful. I'd like one more round of applause for all of them. There's one person who would have really liked to be here tonight, and that is Kevin Starr. Kevin, which you may not know, passed away last week. He was a famous historian, the most preeminent California historian, and former state librarian, and he actually gave the very first George Washington leadership lecture. So we honor his legacy, and he will be missed, Kevin Starr. So thank you all very much for coming. This has been a wonderful evening. We have a lot to think about, and a lot's going to happen, a lot we don't know, but we're going to find out. So we look forward to seeing you at the next George Washington lecture. Thank you very much.